So let's proceed to the fast multiple method. So this first day, it's going to be a little bit curious. You know, the first lecture was very slow. It's concerned undergraduate PDEs, basically. You've seen it. The second lecture will be very fast. And the reason for this is that... Okay. Yeah, it's just that, you know, I want to cover the fast multiple method in large part to familiarize you with my notation and the way that I talk about things. I'm sort of mildly assuming that most of you have some familiarity with fast multiple methods. If not, you might want to, if not, then two things you should know in advance. One is, if you read up on as I posted on the webpage, there's a link to a tutorial. It's an encyclopedia article, actually. It's like 9 pages long. If you read that, that will fill in the gaps. And the second part is that this topic, it has certain complications that aren't really present in the direct solvers. So there's going to be a lot of lists, things like interaction lists. So you have a tree of boxes, and there are ways of keeping track of long-range interactions. And it's a little complex, but if you haven't seen it before, you find the slides confusing. You actually don't need to bone up on it this afternoon. It won't come back. For the direct solvers, interactions are much more close range. They're very precisely for the reason that they have less communication than fast multiple methods. So, you know, this is a very nice set of techniques. I encourage everyone to study them. But it's not the case that if you feel a little bit lost at parts of this lecture, that you're doomed for the rest of the week. It's really, yeah.
Also, the slides are all online.
All
kind of slides are online. You don't check. You don't have to write everything down.
No, absolutely not.
You can read the slides later again.
Okay, and let me also remind you about the bibliographical notes. So for the FMM, it turns out to be very easy, because foundational work was done by Greengard and Rokhlin, and some other key work was done by Rokhlin alone. And these are really the key references. But nevertheless, there's a bunch more details on the webpage. So we're going to look at a very superficially quite simple problem. So we're given n point charges in a domain. So the geometry now is, we have one domain, n charges. They all talk to each other. At each point, we're given a source, qj, and I want to evaluate this sum. So there's a sum here that involves our n squared pairwise interactions. The kernel is the same one from the first lecture. It's the log x minus y. I'm going to use the fact that we've already derived the series expansion for log. So for the most part, we're going to use complex notation here. We're thinking of points as complex numbers. Right. So the issue is evaluating this sum. And I'm going to start by looking at a much simpler problem. So the main difficulty here is that what I call the sources and the targets. So the sources are where I place charges, and the targets are the points where I want the potential. So the difficulty here is that they're the same. Let's start with a much easier problem. So suppose that the sources are confined to a little box. So we're now back to precisely this geometry. And suppose I'm only interested in targets that are away from the box. So they're well separated. So they're in a box whose side length is really 3 times the size of the black box. Okay. So I'm given the two locations. This is the sum I want to evaluate. You can view this as a matrix vector multiply with a matrix of size, a dense matrix of size m times n. And the cost is, of course, O of mn. But in the previous lecture, we derived a separation of variables. So I can write this, the kernel here, log x minus y, as a series expansion where each term in the series is a product of something that depends only on the target location, that's the blue factors, and something else that depends only on the source locations, that's the red factors. Right. So this is so these things arise, you know, all over potential theory, and they're called separation of variables. And for these to be useful, you have to have reasonably rapid convergence. And in this case, we do. So you take this series expansion, you plug it in up here into this expression. On the last set of slides, we had an integral. And then we interchange summation and integration. Now we have a sum. Of course, it doesn't really make a difference. You interchange the two summations. And then you get the following expression. So if you look at the target domains, if you look at the target points, so to first approximation, the field looks really just like a log. So the field looks as if you put, so q hat 0 is just the sum of all the sources. So to first approximation, you sum up all the sources. That gives you what's called the monopole moments. And you approximate the field by putting a just a single source here. The second term is a dipole term. So now you take locations a little bit into account of the sources. And that will somehow give you a dipole moment. So that's the second term. And then it continues up like that. So convergence now, as I mentioned, it's exponential. So it depends, in this case, I call a side of a box to be 2a. So this distance is a. That means that r here is root 2 times a. And I restrict targets to a box that's 3 times as large. So this is big R, which is 3a. So if I restrict my target locations to be far away, then I have exponential convergence. And the rate of convergence is this. So it's root 2 divided by 3. OK. So this allows me to fix a p. So the idea here is that you give me a tolerance. Say you want an answer to 10 correct digits. And then you just crank up p until this expression is 10 to the minus 10. What is that? Is that p equal to 30 or something? Something like that.
Yeah.
And then you truncate the term. You truncate the series expansion. Oh, that should be a p. Right. So now what are the costs? So you need to evaluate the multiple moments, which are these q hat p. And here, each source has to communicate the information to each one of the multiple moments. So each one of the source points contributes to p plus 1 expansion coefficients. So this cost is n times p. Then once you have all the expansion coefficients, the cost of evaluating a potential given a point x is m times p, because now you have to evaluate. For each target point, you have to evaluate the field from each of the p plus 1 expansion functions. So the point here is that we've gone from a multiplicative cost, m times n, to cost p times m plus n. Right. So this is nice. But this is just classical separation of variables. You know, there's no, this is not a fancy algorithm. This has been known for a very long time. And so the one reason I wanted to go over the fast multiple method is that I wanted to talk for a while about things that I'm hoping is familiar to most of you. To introduce that, so I want to cast a lot of these things as linear algebra. So I like thinking of things as matrices. This was greatly confusing, by the way, when I started working with Vladimir Rokhlin, because he much prefers to think about the physics, and I prefer the linear algebra. But it's good to be able to think about it both ways, because sometimes one way is more powerful. And, you know, at least to me, sometimes thinking about it as matrices is helpful. So if you think about what I just said in terms of matrices, then doing the potential evaluation really corresponds to multiplying by a dense matrix. The multiple expansion corresponds to a factorization of this matrix. So A is exactly equal to a factorization where P is infinity. Okay, but that's not very useful. That's very non-useful from a numerical point of view. But the point is that you have exponential convergence. So you can stop after a very moderate number of terms. If you stop after 20 or 30 terms, you get very good accuracy. All right. So So that's thinking about things as a matrix multiplication. Another way that we're going to use to illustrate things graphically is to view these as commutative diagrams. And when I say that they're commutative, I mean that they're commutative to a finite precision. So the map A directly takes the vector of source location and maps to a vector of potentials. Then the multiple expansion you can view as multiplication by C, which is going from a potentially long vector Q down to a short vector Q hat. So Q hat has just P terms. So this is multiple expansion. And then you do evaluation of multiple terms going from the multiple expansion to the potentials. Right. So point being that it's cheaper to go the lower route.
What is the tilde indicating on B? Is there a notational
implication? Yes. What I'm showing here is it's a very condensed version of a fuller description of the fast multiple method. So B tilde has, from the point of view of the fast multiple method, this B tilde is unfortunate because it depends on all sorts of things. It depends on the precise target locations and on the center C. So it's a slightly unfortunate operator. It will be eliminated in the proper fast multiple method. So it will be replaced by a B. So it's the reason for it is laziness on my behalf. I didn't want to develop a totally new notation. And no. To be honest, it's also that, you know, then when you read, you can take this, and then you read the tutorial or the encyclopedia article, and the notation will be the same.
Okay.
Right. All right. So as a general matter, something that is standard, though, for me is that I put hats or tildes on short variables. So I have long variables that are unadorned, and then things with a hat or a tilde is compressed version somehow of that variable. All right. So let's define the concept of well-separated. This will feature prominently in the fast multiple method. So this refers to locations in reference to a box. So if we're given a box omega, then locations that are well separated with respect to omega are locations that are outside of a box, concentric box with three times the size. So these blue points are well separated from omega, the red points are not. So what it means to be well separated is really that multiple expansions converge at the prescribed rate. So remember the path here that you give me a tolerance. Once I have a tolerance, I pick a P that will assure that the multiple expansion is accurate to within whatever tolerance you give me. And then well-separated really means that this is the region where it's safe to use the multiple expansion instead of direct evaluation. You're guaranteed to do things within the prescribed tolerance epsilon. And then multiple expansion, or I'm going to use the term outgoing expansion. So essentially, most of the work I'm going to describe this week, it's intellectually inspired by the fast multiple method. So in the literature, we often call things multipole expansions. So compact representations are oftentimes called multipole expansions, even though they haven't, these days, oftentimes they have nothing to do with multipoles. It's just some very vague intellectual connection. So I'm trying to rectify this by using the term outgoing expansions and incoming expansions to signify that these things can have a much broader sense of meanings than just multiple expansions. But I won't promise to stick to it 100%. I might sometimes slip and say multiple expansion. Okay. So in any case, the multiple expansion for a box, if you're given, or an outgoing expansion, if you're given the box, you're given source locations in it. So you have source strength and locations. There are two pieces of information. So you encode that into this sequence of expansion coefficients. And that sequence of expansion coefficients is the outgoing expansion. So I denote that as the vector Q hat. All right, so let me just do a very, not very clever and moderately useful, slightly accelerated algorithm before the break. And then when we come back, we'll do a more sophisticated algorithm. So now we return to the original problem we started. So remember that for the last 10 minutes, I've talked about this simplified problem where I'm given a set of sources that are well separated from the set of target locations. So this is the easy case. Now let's return to the harder case, where you're given a set of points and there are sources at all points and I want the potential at all points. So now I cannot just plainly do multiple expansion, of course, because it's not convergent inside the box. So what do you do? And what you can do is we can subdivide it into smaller boxes. So we do some sort of divide and conquer. So I'm assuming that the particles are more or less uniformly distributed. I partition the big domain into smaller boxes. Now there's some tuning parameter, little m, which I'm free to choose. This I can optimize. So I put about little m particles in each box, and then I get big N over little m boxes. Then, as I mentioned before, given a tolerance, I pick a term p. That tells me how many multiple coefficients do I need to keep to meet the requested precision. And then for each box, I compute the outgoing expansion. All right. Now, suppose I seek the potentials at these blue points. What do I do? Well, some of these boxes are now well separated. So from the point of view of the blue box, all the boxes with a single red dot in them are well separated. So for all of those boxes, I can safely replace, I can forget about the particle locations, and I can use just the multiple expansion. So use the multiple expansion centered around the center of each one of these boxes. And that will accurately communicate their contributions to the potential inside the blue box. Right. For these guys, where the original points are still shown in this figure, the multiple expansions are not valid. So here I just have to bite the bullet and by brute force evaluate all pairwise interactions. So again, you can now see this connection. That's really what I'm solving here is the Poisson equation, right, with a bunch of delta functions at the locations. So I'm sort of doing numerically now this splitting into a moderately nice close range computation and a smooth, nice long range computation. This is a very simple numerical manifestation of that split. Okay, so what's the cost? So now we have to think about how to pick this tuning parameter m. If you pick it too small, meaning that you have lots and lots of boxes, then there's no gain because evaluating all interactions with the far field boxes will be essentially as expensive as the original problem. If I pick m too large, there's also no gain because then doing the close range evaluations is basically an n squared operation. So the golden point here is to pick root n points in each box. And in that case, you can see that all these different terms balance nicely, and you get basically n to the 1.5 operations. So we've gone from n squared to n to the 1.5. So we're on the right path, but we need to do better. And let's take a break, and then we'll return to that at 10:30.
Sounds great.
All right, thank you. All right, so we're talking about this single-level scheme. You just split the computational domain into a number of equisized boxes. And if you choose the right number of boxes and replace all far-field interactions with multiple expansions, you reduce complexity from n squared to n to the 1.5. And before we proceed, let's just continue a little bit more about this simple algorithm. I'm going to use it to introduce notation, because I'm hoping that everybody is still following. So it might be a good point to discuss notation. So in all these fast algorithms, there's something called lists. And these are really indices. They're a way of keeping track of the geometry, of keeping track of the boxes. So for this single level algorithm, you can number the boxes any way you want. And then for one box, so say this red one, number 21, we're going to introduce a list of neighbors. And it's exactly what it sounds like. It's simply a list of indices that point to the boxes that directly touch. So it's these blue boxes. So basically, the point of this slide is to illustrate just the notation, that a little L like this means a list of boxes. And then for this particularly simple algorithm, we also have a list of far-field boxes. And it's a lot of them. Those are the green ones. And then in addition to this, we're going to introduce another type of index lists. So L's are lists of indices for boxes. In addition, I'm going to have the capital letters I and J. They contain lists of indices to particles. So for a box tau, the variable capital J tau is simply an enumeration of the locations that are inside the box tau. All right. So J tau is a subset of the global index vector 1, 2, 3, up to capital N. All right. So this is notation we use. And then once you have this notation, you can write the algorithm compactly like this. So this is what I call a single-level Barnes-Hut. This is just a term I made up. Barnes-Hut is a known algorithm, and this is sort of a simplification of it. And it looks like this. So we loop over all boxes tau for each one. OK, so now notice, so what's this Q of J tau? So this is a vector that holds all the source strengths of sources inside tau, right? So now, C tau is it's a little matrix that maps this vector to a short vector of multipole expansions. So the multipole expansions are Q hat of tau. Right. So this is the first step. You loop over all boxes. For each one, you compute its multipole expansion. And then the next one is to evaluate all far-field interactions. So now we start by setting the potential to 0. So Q is the input, the vector Q is the input, and the vector U is the output. So first just set it to 0. And then we loop over all boxes, tau. And then for each box, we loop over its far field list. That's the second loop. And just add the contribution from the multipole expansion. Right. So sigma is the second loop variable. And so you just add, as you go, you keep adding up the contributions from the far field. So after this whole segment is concluded, we've done all far field interactions. And then in the final step, we simply add the near field interactions. And A here is the original global matrix. So the exact answer, of course, is U equal to A times Q. That's what A is. But we never, of course, evaluate A itself. We just evaluate these sort of near diagonal entries. And when I say near diagonal, notice that I'm always referring to physical space. So I think of A as an operator from a subdomain of R2 to R2. This is a little bit different than index space, right? So when I say that an element is near diagonal, I don't necessarily mean that if you plot out the matrix, that it's necessarily very close to the diagonal. We're talking about physical space. Right, so this is what the algorithm looks like. And there's going to be a fair number of slides of this nature. So if anything here is unclear, you might want to look this over this afternoon. Right. So now, let's see how can we improve complexity to get closer to linear. So first, we're going to go to n log n, and then to n. So going to n log n is really what's known as Barnes-Hut. It's a slightly more sophisticated level than algorithm than what's Barnes and Hut originally published. But let's call it Barnes-Hut. So what we need to do now is we can't have just a single set of boxes like this. We need a whole hierarchy of boxes. So you start with the original domain. You split it into four, and then continue splitting. So each one of these boxes are split into four, keep splitting. And you can think of this, this is not quite optimal, but think of it that you continue splitting until you have a finite, like a set number of particles in each box, say 100 or 200 particles or something in each box. So you just continue splitting until there's just a handful of particles in each box. Right. Once you've done this, you compute for each one of the boxes. So those of you who are more familiar with the fast multiple method, notice that this is different. So in Barnes' hut, you loop over all the boxes or all the particles, whichever you prefer. But however you do it, for each box, you compute its multiple expansion. Well, not at the very top levels, but for each one of these boxes, you compute the multiple expansion directly from the particle locations. Okay, so the cost of this is n log n, because there are n particles, and each particle communicates its source to each one of the levels above it, but there are at most log n levels. Okay. So the cost of computing all multiple expansions for all boxes is n log n. Once you've done that, now how do you find the potentials at this little box in blue? So we proceed basically as before, separating near field and far field. But now notice that we have a much richer collection of boxes to choose from. So I can choose my tessellation of the far field to involve much fewer boxes. And the criterion now is that this tessellation here is such that I pick the largest possible boxes that are all well separated from the blue box. And this you can do via some sort of top-down procedure. So say you start with looking at this whole box, a quarter box, and you check, is the quarter box well separated from the blue dots? The answer is no. So then you subdivide, and then you look at, say, this box, is this one well separated? Or rather, I should say the opposite, are the blue points well separated from this box? The answer is yes, so we keep it, and then you just loop down. And as you get closer to the blue box, you need to take finer, smaller and smaller boxes. Right. So you can show that you need at most log n boxes. For any leaf box, you can tessellate the rest of space using at most log n boxes. Once you've done that, now take all the ones that are all boxes for which the target box is well separated. You replace the original particle distributions by the multiple expansions and evaluate. So the cost now is n log n for doing this. All right. So this is not bad, but it's not great either. We can get rid of the log n factor. This is this is a description of the Barnes hut. The only real way in which this is more complicated than the single level is you need to think a little bit about how do you find these tessellations. For any target box, you need to find this list of, you know, all the well-separated boxes that tessellate space efficiently. But other than that, it's really quite straightforward algorithm to code up. Okay, so how do we accelerate? So I'm going to do this. So notice that there are three steps, the way I described it. So the cost of computing all outgoing expansions is n log n. The cost of evaluating all potentials from the outgoing expansions is also n log n. And then if you do it the way I described it, we say just affix 200 particles in each leaf box, then the cost of the near field potentials is just O of n. So we need to get rid of these log n factors. And it's somewhat accessible, I believe, how to compute the outgoing expansions efficiently. So let's do that carefully, and then we'll try to tackle the far field potentials. Yes?
What if your points aren't distributed relatively evenly?
Right, so I won't touch on that case, but that is really one of the main advantages of the fast multiple method. So in a nutshell, the fast multiple method can handle non-even particle distributions. And in principle, everything works the same. It's a little more complicated to describe because, I've shown you a couple of these lists. The full fast multiple method for a non-adaptive distribution requires a lot of lists. And since this is not really the main focus of these lectures, I didn't want to spend time on it. But it's really one of the key advantages because notice that for the case that I'm describing now, some of you may already be thinking this, that there's actually an easier way of doing things. That you can do, if you take the single level Barnes hut that I originally described, Now, if you think about it, what you can do is you can do some sort of local interpolation. In each box, put some sort of short expansion coefficient at the center of each box. Then you have a series of charges that are in a perfect lattice. So you want to solve the Poisson equation on a perfect lattice. Do the FFT. Because now this diagonalizes in Fourier space. And that actually is tends to be faster than all of these methods that I've described. Because the FFT is really wickedly fast. So if you have a uniform distribution, everything I've been telling you works. But it's oftentimes not the most efficient way of doing it. But the FFT starts to suffer terribly if you do a non-uniform distribution. So the main application of the fast multiple method is, of course, things like, you know, solving boundary integral equations where the points are distributed on a surface. So they live on a two-dimensional manifold in R3, say. In that case, if you wanted to use the FFT, you would need to put a uniform grid on R3 that sufficiently finely resolves this surface. This just gets very expensive. Whereas for the FMM, it just gets moderately more expensive. So, yes. I was going to mention this at the end, but perhaps. If you're all sitting worrying about why don't you use the FFT, this is the answer. So, anywho, so we have too much communication, basically, in Barnett's hut, that each particle is talking to too much of the rest of space. Can we localize things? How do we get rid of this extra communication? All right. So let's start thinking about, so again, I'm in exactly the same geometry. I put down a quad tree on the domain, a hierarchical tree of boxes. All algorithms, basically, I'm going to describe, are based on some sort of hierarchical subdividing of space. Right, so we put down a quad tree. Now we're looking at the leaves. These are the smallest boxes. And here we proceed just as we did for the single-level Barnett's hut and for the classical Barnett's hut. So for each leaf box, I compute the multiple expansion for the box. All right. I have the cost here of processing the leaves, it's linear, right? Because for each point, each one of the endpoints needs to communicate its source to p plus 1 multiple coefficients. So the cost, to be precise, is np. O of NP. But I'm dropping the P's just to keep notation somewhat uncluttered. Because you can think of all these scalings I mentioned, they're valid for a fixed precision. So if you do a more careful analysis of these methods, you should, of course, specify what's the scaling with respect to tolerance as well. And it's typically logarithmic or logarithmic squared or something like this of the tolerance. All right. But let's think of P as a small fixed number for now. So then each source communicates its source strength to P plus 1 multiple coefficients. Now let's look at a box on the next level up. So this green box here, it lives on the next coarser level. And now I want to compute the multiple expansion about the center of this box. So this is an expansion that allows me to evaluate potentials outside here. So I want some sort of compact representation of the potential caused by all these charges inside the bigger green box that's valid outside here. And in the classical Barnett's hut method, you just do it in the simplistic way. Just take all the point charges and directly communicate their contributions to the multiple expansions about the center of the big box. But there's a better way of doing it, right? Because out here, in the far field of this bigger box, the multiple expansions about the children are valid. For any point out here, these multiple expansions are all valid. So I already have a compact representation of the potential outside of the magenta circle, of the magenta square. So what I can do now is that there exists something called an, so I call it an outgoing from outgoing translation operator. So it takes these four vectors of length p plus 1, and it maps them to another vector of length p plus 1 about this center. So in order to derive this, you basically repeat this argument about Maclaurin expansions, about the center. But now you start not only with monopole charges, but you take all the entire series expansion. You can move the center of that expansion, truncate, and that gives you some little linear operator here.
Right. Good question.
Yes.
So we said that we can take the length p expansions of the child and make it into a length p expansion of the parent of those four children.
Yes.
Is that all? And I didn't have to change p. Is that kernel independent that I can always find a length p?
Yeah, so there's an important distinction here. So there are really, there are two classical cases that people consider. So one are equations that have non-oscillatory fundamental solutions.
Yeah.
So things like Laplace, elasticity, Stokes. So these all behave sort of the same. And in these cases, it is true that the length of the multiple expansion, it really only depends on the ratio between the boxes. So in 2D, you have this, you had the speed of convergence of the multiple expansion depends on the radius of the source region divided by the minimal radius outside of which I evaluate potentials. So it's scale invariance. There's some A here, but it goes away. Right. So for elasticity and Stokes, things work exactly the same. The difference is when we look at Laplace equation, at Helmholtz equation, or time harmonic Maxwell. So things that have a oscillatory fundamental solution. So in that case, everything I said is true as long as the boxes are smaller than, say, one wavelength. Then there exist multiple expansions for the fundamental solution of Maxwell's equations and time harmonic Maxwell and of the Helmholtz equation, but the difficulty is when boxes become several wavelengths large, then you need more and more terms. So in this case, the length depends on the size of the box counted in wavelengths. And there exists a fat multiple method for that case as well. But it's much more subtle. It's not based on just rank considerations. It's based on much more sophisticated kernel expansions than what I'm doing here. So that's something we're not going to cover. Any other questions? No. OK. So in any case, I wanted to conceptually convince you that it should be possible to construct this outgoing from outgoing translation operator, that if I have these outgoing representations of these boxes, there should conceptually exist one of the bigger box as well. OK. This is what it actually looks like. If you work out the details, you know, so the point here being that it's an explicit formula. All the entries of these matrices, they're given analytically. And it depends only on the centers of the two boxes. So here, I drew it. So I'm only showing the algorithm for a very simple tree. You can consider much more general trees. You know, you can shrink the boxes. Once you've split, you can shrink to have the tightest fitting box around the chart, the source location you happen to have, and so on. So this is how I drew this figure. So suppose you're given a multiple expansion around the red box with the red circle, and you want the multiple expansion about the green box with the black center. Then the translation operator looks like this. And it depends really only on this vector between these two centers. Right. So it's easy to evaluate. OK, so now what is the cost of evaluating all outgoing expansions? So you have the cost of processing the leaves. Then we also have the cost of you have the leaves. And now you want to compute the multiple expansions of the next coarser level. Well, how many leaves are there? So again, let's simplistically think about a fixed number of particles in each box, say 200. I'm making it up, but it's, you know, it's a ballpark where you want to choose it. Say you put 200 points in each box, then the number of boxes is basically the same as it's O of n. So the cost of doing the next level is also O of n. Okay. But there are log n levels. So potentially there's a pitfall here. But think about now when you go from the next level, how many boxes do I need to process? Or is it just a quarter as many? Right. So now we're hitting a geometric series. So the cost of processing the leaves is O of n. Okay, so the way I enumerate things, L is the finest level. Okay, so here we're O of n. And processing the next finer level. So let's be a little precise here. Say this, the dominant term here is alpha n. Then going to the next one, it's a quarter alpha n. Because there are only a quarter as many boxes on the next level up. The next level up again, L minus 2. It's 1/16 alpha n. And this series converges. So the computation is essentially, for practical purposes, this computation is completely dominated by the leaf computation. Once you've done that, you're done. OK? So we can compute the outgoing expansions for all boxes in the hierarchical tree very efficiently. All right. Now, let's think about how to aggregate the potentials. And here is the main difference between Barnes-Hutt and the fast multiple method. So now I need a new type of expansion. So now I'm going to, so the trick to defeat log n, n log n for computing the outgoing expansions was to hierarchically construct the outgoing expansions. Now I'm going to introduce an incoming expansion that I can analogously construct via a hierarchical procedure. So the outgoing expansions are constructed via a sweep from the bottom, the finest boxes, to the top. The incoming expansions are going to be constructed by a dual sweep from the coarsest boxes to the finest ones. All right. So before we do this, we need to define what the incoming expansion is. So consider a box in the tree, a green one. It has a center as before. And now I'm going to introduce a list. So this list really only exists on this slide. It does not really come up in the fast multiple method. This list is not going to be included in the algorithm, the slide that shows the algorithm for the fast multiple method. It's just a temporary crutch. Same thing with this potential phi. It's never explicitly evaluated. That's why I don't. It really depends on tau and so on. But it only lives on this in the next slide, and then we'll forget about it. But just to define what the incoming expansion is. So let phi be a function of x, where x is restricted to this box. And it's the potential that's generated by point sources that are all well separated. OK? Now, as we discussed this morning, phi is a harmonic function. It's an analytic function on this green box. And again, because it's a potential that's caused by sources that are far away. So recall the whole discussion about solving the Poisson equation applies. And so we can very efficiently expand this potential phi using harmonics, most easily expressed in terms of just a Taylor expansion using complex variables. And here we know, so phi of x, it's analytic. It has, we can write it as an infinite expansion. The rate of convergence is again given just by the ratio between the radii. So it converges exponentially fast, with the speed being root 2 divided by 3 to the pth power. Yeah. So I can truncate this expansion. and get everything to precision epsilon, or whatever tolerance you give me. All right. So now these expansion coefficients, so the compact representation of phi, it's a series of complex numbers that represents the coefficients basically in a Taylor expansion of the potential about the origin. And know the potential is harmonic, it's analytic, rapidly convergent, so short expansion will give me all the accuracy I need. All right, so the outgoing expansion or the multiple expansion is a compact representation of all the sources in a box. The incoming expansion, or Taylor expansion, is a local expansion, is the classical name in the fast multiple method. So it's a series of coefficients that represents the potential induced by all charges that are well separated from the box. All right, so that's the incoming expansion. Now, how do you compute it? Or is everybody with me? You now know what the incoming expansion is. Compact encoding of the potential caused by far field boxes. And this slide is just, you know, in case somebody feels uncomfortable about complex numbers, just take the real parts. And you see that it's really just an expansion in sines and cosines with appropriately weighted R's in front. Okay? So how do you compute it? So this is a top-down computation. We start with the coarsest, with the largest boxes. So at the next box, so I've skipped the top two levels. I don't need, so for the root box is the entire domain, right? It has no well-separated point charges, so I don't need to care about it at all. And even the next level, on level one, when I take these quarter-sized boxes, they also have no sources that are well-separated, so just ignore them. So we start at level two. So now, consider this green box. How do I compute its incoming expansion? Well, so this is the potential that's caused by all these red dots. But these boxes are all well-separated. So what I can do now is that I can replace all these red dots by multiple expansions in the corresponding boxes. Okay, and now there's a series expansion. There's an analytic formula for how to translate a multiple expansion to an incoming expansion. I was debating back and forth whether I should put it on a slide doing these translations, but I judge by myself that I cannot follow such things when I watch a talk. But I hope you'll believe me when I say, conceptually, you can do it. So u of x here, it's analytically given as a sum of multiple expansions. And just take that expansion and compute its Taylor expansion around the center here, the blue point. See? And then you get these, what I call, incoming from outgoing expansions. So some of you might be a little irritated that I'm changing notation, but this is, in the FMM, these are called multipole to local translation operators. There's a reason why I'm changing, and it's because once we go to direct solvers, we're going to compress boxes that directly touch. So multiple expansions are not going to work. So we're going to have different types of compact expansions. The same concepts will still survive. So there will be compact representations of sort of information of sources, say, inside a box, and there's compact representations of potentials induced by outside sources, but there's not going to be a buffer region. So multiple expansions won't do it. We need to numerically construct the outgoing and incoming expansions. They have a very different exact meaning. Conceptually, the meaning is the same. And I want to introduce language here that will work for all sorts of settings. Okay, so the incoming from outgoing translation operator exists. So this is a little matrix of size p plus 1 times p plus 1. And here's something that I call an interaction list. This is the list of boxes for which the green box needs to collect its incoming expansion. I'll define it in just a second. Before I give you a formal definition, let's think a little bit about Now that we go to a box on the next finer level, how do we compute the incoming expansion here? Okay, so now things start to get a little hairier. It's starting to smell a little bit like the original Barnes hut, because now the incoming expansion of this green box, it's a potential caused by all of these red sources. Right, so there's a lot of them. So what I can do here is, of course, I can sort of use this idea of Barnes hut, and I can tessellate this red area into as big boxes as I can, and then use the outgoing expansions to translate. If I do that, I'll be doomed to n log n complexity, because as the boxes get finer and finer, the number of well-separated boxes will eventually hit log n. So this is no good. But I don't have to, right? Because think about this. Let's look at one specific box. Think about the sources in here. Now, they've communicated their contribution to the parent box of the green box. OK, so now when I'm sitting in this green box, I already know what the incoming potential caused by these guys are. It's encoded by my parent. So I can just fetch that information from my parent. So forget about all these boxes that were processed on the next coarser level. They've already been handled. My parent knows that stuff, so I can get that from my parent. And that's being done by something that's called an incoming from incoming expansion. So from my parent, I fetch the representation of everything that was well separated from him or her. OK, but that remains. But so now there's a number of boxes that are well separated from me, but were not well separated from my parent. So for these guys, I do need to collect more stuff, because these boxes contribute to the incoming expansion for the green box. But they did not contribute to the incoming expansion for the parent. So I must explicitly add these. OK, so this, again, is the same operator as was on the last slide. So here we have the incoming from outgoing expansion. And again, the sum is over what I call an interaction list. All right, so on the next slide, I'm going to define the interaction list. But is everybody with me conceptually? Like, this, I think, is the main intellectual hurdle in the fast multiple method. We're good. All right. All right, so now interaction list, how do you define it properly? So it's a list of boxes, and it's a list. So tau is a given box. Its interaction list consists of boxes that are on the same level. They must all be well separated, because in the interaction list is where I'm going to translate outgoing expansions to incoming expansions. All right. And then the third point you can express in different ways. Perhaps it's more clear to say that so sigma and tau are well separated, but the parents of sigma and tau are not well separated. So the interaction between these two boxes was not processed on the next coarser level. Right. So you see how this works? So, right. So let's look at this box. It's not well separated from the green one, so it's not in the interaction list. If we look at this box, then its parent is this guy. And that is not well separated. That is well separated from the parents of the green box. So this box is not in the interaction list. OK? So that's how it works. Here's actually not an expression for the incoming from outgoing translation operator. Now things start to get a little bit messy. And when you write these things down, you have to. So the zero order moment is usually handled a little bit different than the other ones. So these formulas get a little long. And I think that they basically detract from the presentation. If you want, if you're curious about them, you can go look it up. You know, there's numerous references referenced on the web page. All right, so basically proceeding this way down the tree, we can compute the incoming potential, the incoming expansions for each box. And then eventually we hit the leaves. And when you're done at the leaf, so the green box here is the leaf, how do you actually evaluate the potentials inside the leaf? Well, so everything that's well separated. So the boxes for which in the Barnes-Hutt method we needed to do a log n complexity fetch are now already being taken care of. They're all encoded in the incoming expansion. So on the leaves, I have the incoming expansion. That represents the far field. So all I need to do here is I expand it really. So this is what I call a targets from incoming translation operator. So that hits the incoming expansion for the box. Right. So that's, now I know the far field. And then these contributions are just contributions from things that are not well separated. So I have to evaluate them explicitly. Okay. And this is what it looks like. So this is the fast multiple method. And I probably don't need to spend too much time on it. I just want to touch on a few high-level things. So there's a sweep over the leaves. This is where I go from. This is the only time I touch the sources. So the actual vector of sources are really only touched in the first and the last step. So here, I construct the outgoing expansions for all the leaves. There's a pass through the tree going from the finest level up. So there's a single pass. This is the where I compute all the outgoing expansions. I apply these outgoing from outgoing operators. Then there's a pass, which you can do in any order. So some of these operations commute. So you can apply all these incoming from outgoing translation operators. You can really do it in any order you want. But somehow you need to communicate. The outgoing expansion of each box has to be communicated to the incoming expansions in all the boxes in its interaction list. There are at most 27 boxes in the interaction list. So this is a modest cost in terms of, there's no log n factor. This is the most expensive cost typically in the fast multiple method. And then there's a downwards pass. So once I've completed this one, now every box holds an incoming expansion that represents contributions from its interaction list. So now to get the full incoming expansions of all boxes, I need to do a top-down sweep where I propagate the contributions from the parents down in the tree. So this is a single downward sweep in the tree. And then you simply add or you expand the incoming expansions to the actual target locations, and then you add the contributions of points that are close. Right. So if I were to present, so the fast multiple method for non-uniform trees, it looks exactly the same. Like all these steps are the same, but there are two additional lists that need to be processed. So because the tree is non-uniform, sometimes you need to directly transfer sources to incoming expansions for some boxes. Because you basically have some sort of level mismatch. So there are some exceptional boxes. And if you're not cautious, you can actually end up linear complexity. So you have to subdivide the tree carefully and stuff. But sort of conceptually, everything works the same. And let me wrap up. So first, now I'm done with my presentation of the classical FMM. In two dimensions. I'm going to briefly discuss generalizations, but this is a good time to take questions about the 2D FMM, if there are any.
No. So, why is there how do we count these 27 interactions going on?
Ah, right. Why are there 27? Right, so here's the box tau. So how many guys are there in its interaction list? Right, so I have to go up to the next coarser level. So who's the parent of tau? So here's the parent nu. So it's things that are not well separated from nu. So now there are, we have to look at the neighbors of nu. So these are what, the uncles of tau, I guess? I don't know a gender-neutral word for uncle. Uncles and aunts. Okay. So the parent of tau has 8 immediate neighbors, 8 immediate siblings. So we have to consider all the possible children of these guys. Anything that's located outside of the siblings of the parent was taken care of at coarser levels. Right. So now, how many points, how many boxes do we have? Okay, so now we have 6 squared boxes. So there are 36 potential boxes that could be in the interaction list, because otherwise they were taken care of on coarser levels. But now we have to subtract. The box itself is clearly not in the interaction list. And I also need to subtract the immediate neighbors. So now the number is 6 squared minus 3 squared. So this is 27. That's how you. Of course, if it could be a little bit less. So if tau is located at the edge of the computational domain, then there are fewer. If you have a non-uniform tree, then a lot of these boxes will be empty, and they will not be touched at all. So about 27 is an upper bound. All right. But now, this actually is it's almost like a planted question. I wish I'd thought to plant that question, but I was lucky. What happens in 3 dimensions? The exact same argument works, right? But now, my parent has, he doesn't have nine siblings. The parent has 27 siblings. So we have 6 cubed potential guys in the interaction list. And then we subtract 27 boxes. Ah, yes, thank you. All right. And what is this? Goodness. Yeah. Right. So notice that 189 is a much larger number than 27. And is it right now? Okay. Right. So, but this is an important point. 189 is much larger than 27. But it's even worse, because how many terms do you need in the multiple expansion? So in 3D, you have 2 angular directions, basically. So there are much more multipole expansion. There are much more terms in the multipole expansion for a given accuracy. So basically, in order to attain a specified tolerance epsilon, I need I do a multipole expansion of order p, where p is log 1 over epsilon. I still have exponential convergence, but the problem is that the number of coefficients that I need grows. So I have p squared, in this case, coefficients, which means that the translation operators, the incoming from outgoing translation operators, they're not really p squared operations anymore. They're p to the 4th power. So I have 189 times p to the fourth. It's the cost of translating outgoing expansions to incoming expansions. And this really is quite prohibitive. This is a very high cost. And when the fast multiple method was first published, it turns out that in practice, oftentimes Barnes Hut was faster because it didn't have this cost. And it was easier to code. So, you know, some people, and most interesting computations are in 3D, so people were like, why bother with the FMM? But then, successively, several things have happened since the 80s. So one thing is that better methods, of better versions of the fast multiple method have been published. The 189 number you can't improve upon, really, for a general particle distribution. But you can greatly accelerate how you translate outgoing expansions to incoming expansions. So going from p to the fourth to p cubed turns out to be quite easy. And you can actually even go to p squared if you use more sophisticated ways of doing this. And there are references on the web page to various papers describing this. So they're much more efficient. So in 3D, the way I describe things is not really how you do things. It's conceptually the same, but you need to do various tweaks to get an efficient algorithm. Then the other thing that's changed from the 80s is that how much you pay for the log n factor really depends on how big your problem is. If n is a million, say, then it really doesn't matter that much. Log of a million is not that much. But these days, computers are much bigger. So if n is 10 to the 12, then the log n factor is starting to really hurt you. So the fact that you have better scaling, even slightly better scaling, really makes a big difference. You have this whole Moore's law business, right? Which means that every year you get a constant improvement in the ratio between your competitors, right? So having the right scaling algorithm is, you know, it's very important for future proofing. Yes?
So has someone proved that the FMM is, in some sense, an optimal way of adding contributions?
I mean, it's optimal in the scaling of n because it's linear. But maybe you're asking more. So then there's a prefactor. So there's a prefactor to n that depends on the accuracy, for instance. And whether that one is optimal, I honestly don't know. Does anybody else know? I mean, I don't think that's, you know, I think that the state of the art, and especially, so the FMM turns out to parallelize quite well. I'm going to argue that direct methods are even slightly better in certain regards. But the FMM parallelizes very well. It parallelizes better, it certainly parallelizes much better than Barnes Hut. But, so that happened, you know, that crossover was maybe 20 years ago or 30 years ago. But a more recent thing that's happened is that the FMM is starting to win over the FFT on very large problems because the FFT is harder to parallelize. So, I mean, the practical answer is that my understanding is that for these types of computations, descendants of the FMM are the state of the art. But I don't exactly know, you know, if there's a computer science type complexity proof. But it would have to be on, in regards to accuracy.
Right. Yeah. What is a good general thought about the number of points you have? It's like mean one, like switch from being just like the direct computation to switch from being
oh. To be honest, I don't really use the FMM much, so I don't know. There are probably members of the audience who.
5,000?
Yeah. In 3D?
What's the question?
What the practical crossover point? When should you go from n squared direct evaluation to the FMM? Okay. Thank you. Right. So, in connection with this discussion of 3D, Imagine this point. So if you want to use the FMM, notice that the method that I described is actually not that hairy to code. You can do it pretty quickly. But it's a little atypical in that regard, that Laplace's problem in 2D is uncharacteristically easy. 3D is harder. You have to really be careful about how you implement the various translation operators. And there's a big difference between, you know, the lazy implementation that, you know, can be done in a few days by somebody who knows what they're doing, and a careful implementation done by an expert who has a lot of time. So if you can at all, you should use canned code. This gets even more true for Helmholtz. So we already touched upon this, that the FMM really relies on this smoothing property. And for Helmholtz equations, so equations that have an oscillatory kernel, like Helmholtz and time harmonic Maxwell, they smooth and everything that's finer than the wavelength. So sub-wavelength things, everything I talked about, applies. Then as the boxes start growing larger than a wavelength, this methodology will start to degrade. You will need longer and longer multiple expansions until eventually it becomes prohibitive. But at that point, you can switch to a different FMM. So there exists a totally different way of doing the long-range interactions that's much more like a Fourier transform, that sort of the interactions are diagonal in Fourier space, properly interpreted. So you're switching from one type of representations at the small boxes to a different type of representation at the large boxes. Exactly how you do this transitioning is sort of subtle. So this is something, unless you're a hardcore researcher in the field, it's generally better to use canned FMMs, I would say, for Helmholtz. They're really quite subtle to code. So see if you can find one if you want to use it. And that regime, I should say, there is really a quite remarkable fact that there exists O of n algorithms, or n log n, for Helmholtz in this case, because I think when the FMM was developed, just as a little historical note, it made a big splash, but I think mathematicians were not shocked that this is possible, because it's known, you know, everything I said about the solution operators, this has been known a very long time. And, you know, it was not shocking to people that this would be possible. Whereas the fact that you could do it for high-frequency problems was really unexpected, and it's one of the major discoveries of the last several decades, I would say, in numerical analysis. Before we close, let me just give you my little, just to drive home the point about the difference between sub-wavelength and super wavelength. So when I give talks, I sometimes make this analogy about if you want to observe the moon, if you want to try to discern things about the moon, you could, in principle, measure the gravitational field on Earth and do some sort of inverse imaging to try to reconstruct what does the moon look like. But the gravitational field over here is essentially indistinguishable from the field generated by a point source. So if the moon was just an infinitesimally small point source located at a point, the gravitational field would look essentially exactly the same. I haven't actually run the numbers, but maybe if you measure super carefully, you could find a dipole moment or something. But you really lose everything. Whereas if we look at the wave spectrum, if you look at it with a telescope, you get to see a tremendous amount of detail. And this is, you know, it's time harmonic Maxwell that's the governing equation here. And it just does not lose information because the wavelength in the optical field is very, very small. So things that are smaller than that, the only way it loses is really that, you know, the field gets too thin. There are not enough photons to detect. But there's no smoothing effect here above the wavelength. Waves are just going straight, and they're perfectly preserving the information. So this is just a useful thing to keep in mind. And, computationally, it's some sort of intermediate regime that's really the hardest. So once you're in the really small wavelength regime, then there are other techniques. You can do ray tracing. In some sense, it's an easier numerical problem. But so I shouldn't say easy, but there are techniques to handle when the wavelength gets really short. And this type of techniques can handle sub-wavelength phenomena. And the regime in between is where a lot of the major challenges are. And I think that concludes my second lecture. Are there questions? Yes.
And how does comparing
the FMM and I don't think people really use tree codes much. So I'm guessing, I mean, I certainly don't. So I can't give you a definitive answer because I don't. But so tree codes, as I understand the term, is a general term for things that are behave like Barnes huts, basically. So they're easier to code. So you know, some people use them. If you just you have some problem with n squared complexity, you with a small computational effort want to get it down to n log n, then a tree code might be a good option, but I don't think they're really used much for truly high-performance computing. That's the very precise.
I'd say if one wants, agrees to use an FMM package, so then the user would enter a set of sources, a set of points, and an address, and that's it?
Yes. Yes, you enter the vector of source location, and then a vector of source strength. And then, oftentimes the default is that the output, the target points are the same as the sources. Sometimes you can enter a different vector of target points. And then in practice, of course, so if you have an FNM for Helmholtz, you might have a situation where the inputs are monopoles, and they might be dipoles. For the output, you might be interested in just the field, you might be interested in fields and gradients of the field and things like this. So, in practice, the calling sequence is a little more complicated, but basically, yes. The input is just locations, sources, and an accuracy.
Yeah.
What do you mean, diagonal policy? This is complicated. I won't go there, but basically, the translation operators in 3D, I mentioned that if you have multiple expansion of order p, you have p squared multiple coefficients implemented naively. The map that maps outgoing to incoming expansions has p cubed complexity. So it turns out that you can diagonalize these operators in certain ways. So you do some little local maneuvers, and then there's a diagonal translation operator. So that complexity is really only p squared. And then you do some little local maneuvers at the receiver. And the way, in two sentences, what you do is you expand the field in plane wave expansions. So then the translation becomes just translating a plane wave expansion, which is very easy. But it's a whole business. It's complicated. I just don't want to go there. Yeah.
Yeah. And what about like a butterfly type algorithm? Where is it fitting?
So they fit in more like high-frequency FMMs. Now we have the expert on butterfly algorithms right here. But the way I view it is that, so here you tessellate the computational domain, and then corresponding to a tessellation of physical space, there's some sort of tessellation of the linear operator of the matrix, and you have off-diagonal blocks. The off-diagonal blocks have low numerical ranks; their singular values decay. So the butterfly algorithm in the two-sentence description you have a whole higher, you have a sequence of different levels, and you tessellate the matrix differently. And it's sort of a generalization of the FFT. But you can, so you, most people don't view the FFT as a low rank algorithm, but when you invoke butterfly, it's sort of a way of viewing the FFT as some sort of low rank thing. But it's a much more subtle low rank decomposition. And again, that would take quite some time to go into. So we can take it offline afterwards. I think we're a few minutes over time, so maybe we should continue discussions over lunch.
Yeah. Great.
Yep. Thank you.